Alright, so before every season, we all have our questions that we hope will be answered as the year goes on. Today, I wanted to look at what everybody was asking just over 4 months ago in October, with the intention of putting a conclusion to all of our wonders. Like always, if you're new, please like, subscribe, comment, all of that. I would really appreciate it. And if you love basketball, this is the place to be. So with that being said, let's get into this video. Last offseason, we witnessed three really sizable moves in the association, and obviously, these trades had everybody questioning if the franchise has made a winning move. Now, I'm gonna go in the order the deals were made, so let's start off with the Atlanta Hawks. They pulled the trigger on DeJounte Murray, and this video isn't necessarily talking about whether it was a fleecing, but three firsts is a lot to give up anyways. Those two in the backcourt, they were supposed to play off each other very well, and initially, it seemed like a great fit to help Trae Young with his off-ball struggles. So far, this revamped Hawks team, they were struggling for most of the campaign, but now it seems like they're finally hitting their stride. I just talked about them, so I'll be really quick. But Trae and DeJounte have started shooting really efficiently, and that's kind of what they need to do to win games. Because even though they added Murray, that defense still really hasn't gelled. A lot of us clowned the Wolves for the Rudy Gobert trade, and I admit it, it was still way too much to give up, but Minnesota, they're quietly in the playoffs as of now. The stats don't really show you what their problem is, because if you were to pull up Rudy Gobert on StatMuse or Basketball Reference, whatever, it looks as if he's pretty solid. However, we seem to forget something, and that's that Minnesota is not playing the same group of guys that they would be in the postseason. Cat has been out basically 3 months, and when he comes back, he's probably not going anywhere. That's just my opinion. In the only span that those two bigs got to play together, the Wolves were a bottom half team in almost every aspect. I mean, they were fourth from the bottom in 3-point shooting and turnovers, and really, it was already clear that two non-complementary 7-footers on the court together, that would just be awkward. Mind you, just like how he was exploited in the playoffs several times, bigs with the perimeter game have been shooting really well on Rudy, because his lateral quickness really isn't there. In my eyes, Gobert is a player that needs to have a team built around him, because he's essentially a rim protector with no offense. So Minnesota's experiment, it may have already been proven as a bad idea, but I guess we'll have to wait and see, because they're playing well right now. The only really positive deal on both sides, actually, that occurred in the summer was based around Donovan Mitchell. Funnily enough, the Cavs got exactly what the Hawks were hoping for. Like I said in my East predictions video, Darius Garland has some elite playmaking skill, especially at his age, and Mitchell himself, he's become extremely efficient now that he's the secondary ball handler. I mean, we watched him score 71 not that long ago. He's definitely a lethal scorer. Cleveland, they're probably not a title contender this year, but they've already made a huge jump, and they could be really scary next season. Coming out of September, the Boston Celtics and Phoenix Suns, we didn't know what was next for them, because they lost huge parts of their franchise. Without the head coach that led them to the finals in his first year, how would the Celtics perform? And without the owner that built a championship-contending roster, was the Suns' window over? Since then, these two teams, they've blown those questions out of the water. Boston was the undisputed best team in the East for a pretty long time. I mean, they were on pace to have the best offense ever for a good amount too. As for the Suns, they literally introduced their new owner on the same night they made the move for Kevin Durant. Since he joined the starting lineup, Phoenix hasn't won by less than 14 points, and they've sneakily been a really good defensive team. Having KD in that lineup, it's really taken a lot of pressure off Devin Booker, because as good of a scorer as he is, he's not the best on the team anymore, and opponents focus on him less than they used to. That's let him score a really efficient 37 and 35 points back-to-back. At the moment, they're the two favorites to win the championship, so it's fair to say anyone's doubts have been answered. So Jordan Poole and Draymond, they had that incident before the season that made everyone question what the Warriors were gonna look like. A lot of people thought that this would be the end of their dynasty, and that looked like it could have been the case up until Christmas. Keep in mind, by no means is this Warriors team a definite contender, but they've been showing signs of that recently, no doubt. On Christmas Day, they beat their hated rival Memphis, and that was kind of a catalyst for what they did in the future. For that game, they were 3 games under .500 for the entire season. That was mainly because of the fact that they played terrible defense. I mean, they were struggling to close out on the perimeter, and that led to easy, high-percentage field goal attempts for the opposition. Now, that doesn't mean they've completely fixed their problems, but it's true that they've become 70-80% as solid as they were last year when they won it all. Anyways, that game against the Grizzlies, it was the first of a 5-game win streak, where they tightened up on both sides of the ball and found themselves over 500 for the first time since a month prior, all without their best player. Now, Steph Curry, he was having one of his best seasons ever, which is crazy to think about, because in his prime, he was one of the best we've ever seen. I mean, at 34 years old, he's almost putting up 30 points a night and shooting really efficiently. Only behind the years Golden State was at the height of their dynasty. The first time Steph was out of the lineup for a long time, the Warriors fared pretty well. But when he got injured again in early February, a lot of people thought the team would fall off. But that really hasn't been the case. Since then, they've jumped from the 8th seed to the 5th seed, thanks to Klay and Jordan Poole stepping up. It looks like Klay is back in form now, and Jordan Poole, he's undoubtedly the future there in San Fran. Despite everything that happened, this Warriors team, they're showing everybody that they still have it. And I think they're a contender in the West when Steph comes back, just because of the experience that they all have. A big question coming into the season was, when will Lonzo Ball return? And unfortunately for Bulls fans, that question was answered not long ago. A while before it was officially announced, a lot of people doubted that Lonzo would even play a game this year. And those people were correct. I mean, they say he's still not comfortable playing basketball. Knowing that he would be out for a while or possibly indefinitely, the question was proposed about how Chicago would do without him. And so far, it's obvious that Zoe makes a huge difference in that lineup. Last year, up to the point of Lonzo's injury, they were the 1 seed and 14 games over an even record. In 106 games without him, they're 10 games under 500. That's a huge drop-off. Not to mention the fact that their offense, it's gotten much worse without the playmaker that held everything together. And they're also lacking that dynamic perimeter defender. I mean, imagine the depth they would have with Zoe, Caruso, and Patrick Beverley. Thank you guys for watching, I appreciate it so much. If you're new, or haven't done so yet, please like and sub if you enjoyed, and I'll see you guys in the next one.